What's up, Slackers? Welcome back to another episode of the Slackcast, episode 43 for what it's worth. I'm your host, Pete Imbesi, here with my ever-present co-host, Andy Brown.
Is it worth anything that this is episode 43? Yeah. Is there a monetary value attached to that?
I think 43 cents.
Okay.
Is exactly... Each episode is worth about one penny, cumulatively, at the end of it. So, if this is your first time on the show, this is the Slackcast, where some subsection of the Slack and Slash gang gets together to talk about news, video games, and how it all makes us feel. So we're going to kick the show off the way we do every week by talking about what we're playing this week.
Sir.
Yeah, so pretty much the same as last week. We're going to talk a little bit more about it in the main topic of the show, but I'm still knee-deep in Horizon and Breath of the Wild. But I will say, I think last week I was saying how I'd kind of been leaning more of my time towards Horizon over Legend of Zelda, and this kind of switched a little bit this week where I put, I think, another 4 or 5 hours in Horizon, and I've put, like, another... I think I played, like, the first 2 hours last time we spoke. I think I'm, like, 13 or 14 in now.
Damn.
So, I've been playing, I mean, both of them whenever I get a chance, but specifically this week, like, any time I've had a spare moment, my mind's kind of been with Zelda, and as a result, whenever I can, I've been grabbing it and playing.
Just carrying that Switch in your jacket pocket. Where it fits perfectly.
Oh yeah, dude. It's awesome. Like, so I've got like a nice pea coat that's got like an inside jacket pocket, and I've got the little carrying case that they made for the Switch, and it slides right in there like a glove. So
legit? Yeah.
I've been taking it with me like everywhere just in case I have the chance to show it off or fuck around with it. So yeah, like I said, we're going to talk more about Zelda in the meat and potatoes this week, so I don't want to harp on it too much.
Cool. Yeah.
Other than that, been playing League. Things are going terribly, as per usual.
I'm hitting that, like, nice spring burnout where I'm not going to play League for a month or two, I think.
Yeah?
It's just, like, I played so much League this winter.
Dude, I mean, like, that sucks because we didn't play much together, and, like, I super need help getting out of bronze.
I mean, I'll still play with you.
Like, everyone's trash.
But
dude,
it's just, like, I don't know, I'm going back to school in the fall, and I'm trying to get through all these, like, big, meaty fucking RPGs.
Yeah. So you definitely, like, you've got priorities.
Yeah.
Yeah, man, it's just, like, I feel like every game I've had in 2017 has boiled down to my team falling apart because of, like, low morale, or, like, I do super well and someone else on my team feeds, you know, or throws the game. It's like, the other night I was playing, it was like my girlfriend was over, I'd, like, just finished up writing an article for CBR, and, like, I didn't really feel like jumping into Zelda or something because I didn't want to, like, get sucked into it for a few hours, you know? Just wanted to, like, kind of play something while we were watching TV. So I'm like, I play like 3 or 4 games a League, and I get to play Lux, who's my main, like, every time I had a positive KD spread of, like, between, like, it was like 4 to 6 or 7 kills, and, like, just lose. Like, it's like, I can't carry any harder, guys.
That sucks.
Yeah,
it sucks. Yeah, so, but I've not played any League this week, actually. It's just been Tales of Berseria.
Yeah, you've been, like, really into that. Like,
yeah, look, I fucking love that game. I love the Tales series. I love JRPGs. This podcast has been, like, a pretty good document of me being weeb trash.
No.
As we say in the West.
You play JRPGs all the time and reference Dragon Ball Z every episode? You're not a weeb.
But Tales of Berseria is, like, it's got some bunch of really smart design, where, like, every time you start to get, you know, it lets you flex a little bit with the mechanics, and then it adds another wrinkle.
Mm-hmm. That's what I really like. Horizon does a really good job of that.
Yeah.
Like, getting you comfortable with what you've already done.
Gets
and
you
then
comfortable, and then you get to, like, you know, the second it starts feeling, like, rote, it's just like, oh, and then here's another party member. Now you can do this, like, swap on the fly thing mid-battle.
Cool.
Yeah.
That's great. And you said you're 12, 15 hours in?
12, 13-ish hours, yeah. I still don't have the whole party.
Yeah, a lot of waiting to go. I mean, yeah, I wouldn't imagine so. I mean, it's like a 50-hour game.
Yeah,
right?
There's only 6 party members, though.
Okay, so what are you at, like?
I'm at 5.
Okay.
It's really smart about how it's done it. All of the party members that you recruit have been, like, boss fights before they get recruited.
I like that.
Yeah. And then, like, the one character, Magilu, is actually, like, the first big NPC you meet.
Okay.
Outside of, like, Velvet and Artorias, who's the bad guy. Like, his antagonist, because, like, he's kind of the Pope. She just, like, hangs out with you forever being shitty and, like, well, I can't do magic. And then plot stuff happens, and she's like, oh, what? Yeah, I'll just kill everybody for you now. It's great.
Is that the character that uses explosion magic?
No.
Or is that something else? That's something else. I'm sorry. Thompson is also playing that game with his girlfriend. And I think that he was telling me about an anime where someone has explosion magic, and
okay.
I think I just crossed wires there. Sorry about that.
Well, I wish Thompson was here so we could talk about this game. I love it. It's maybe my favorite cast of characters in an RPG ever.
Yeah. I mean, that's cool, man.
It's up there with Chrono Trigger, and it's fun being the bad guys for once.
Yeah, that's like a really high, that's a high praise, man.
Yeah. The voice acting does wonders for it. It's like, if you ever played a Tales game, you know, like the skits and stuff they had?
Yeah.
If those are fully voice acted now.
Okay.
Which is great because it's not like Tales of Symphonia in particular. I read quick. I can't speed up watching them like anime talk through it without.
Yeah, that always bothered me too. Where it's like, and it's like the text is just crawling. It's like, can I just skip and read?
Yeah.
Like, you know, like this is a pretty low below my reading level here. Like I can get through this.
You have to have friendship and courage. It's important, Lloyd.
I get it.
But yeah, Tales of Berseria. Check it out. Definitely. It's like $50 on Steam.
Yeah.
$60 on PS4. You can get it on sale. Probably pretty easily.
Probably pretty soon too. I would imagine you'll see a sale when Persona 5 comes out.
Yeah. Bandai does like a lot of sales.
So yeah, keep an eye open for it. That's cool. Yeah, and same for the stuff I'm playing. If you haven't already picked up Zelda or Horizon, you're sleeping on it, so.
Friend of the show, Mike McMahon's a fucking monster, guys.
Oh, God, yeah, tell the story.
Okay, so I was hanging out with Mike the other night, lamenting how I haven't bought a Switch. And Mike, my birthday's at the end of July, for reference. Mike decides he's going to buy my birthday present now and purchase a copy of Breath of the Wild for me. Just as an incentive to buy a Switch, or so, you know, when you get around to it, it's there for you, man.
What an unbelievable monster. Well, we love him. So,
yeah,
go tweet at Mike McMahon NJ and thank him for being a monster and trying to coerce Andy into joining the Switch Nation. So, anything else?
Nothing else, really. I'm really excited to start playing Mass Effect this week, though.
Yeah, dude, if you do that that pre-release thing, we should really do, like, a stream. That would be cool.
I think there's, like, a bunch of NDAs that are, like,
are you serious?
Yeah.
That can't even be the case if they're selling it to you, really? Like, we'll
it's like
see.
It's like
we'll
early
see.
Access, yeah.
Okay, we'll have to see. Maybe we can't do that, but that would be fun if we could get away with that. I would love to get through the first couple hours of that game. But, dude, I am, like, I'm getting increasingly nervous that I'm going to finish neither of these games before Mass Effect comes along, and I'm just going to be, like, juggling all three of them then. It's like...
Yeah, it's like, I might just, like, retreat into my little cave for the next week or so. We're supposed to get a blizzard on Tuesday, which is nice.
Dude, I really hope so. Like, that would be great.
Just, like, you know, put in a fire, snuggle up my boo, play some Tales of Berseria, hand her a controller, be like, it's really not that hard. Just, like, press buttons and go beat dudes up.
Yeah. I'll just watch. I don't know.
Tails has, like, multiplayer in the battles, yeah.
What? That's
awesome.
Yeah, because
they have, like, the action battles.
Oh, right,
stuff.
Right.
So you only control the one character. You can have, like, up to four people, I think. Just,
that's
like,
sick.
Slot in on a controller and jam out.
That's really fun. Yeah, man, the one thing I'm thinking is, like, I played the original Mass Effect trilogy, like, largely with my girlfriend. So
yeah.
I'm thinking maybe I'll make Mass Effect my... I play this when we're together, and I'll play everything else on my own.
Snuggle up with you, boo.
Yeah, exactly. Be like a good, I guess Walking Dead will probably be over soon. I was going to say, I usually go and watch that with her on Sundays. It could be like a good, okay, that show's over, let's play Mass Effect now.
That show's over, Game of Thrones doesn't come back till July.
Yeah, got a nice gap there. Or I'll just start doing that instead of Walking Dead when it ends. It's like, alright, Mass Effect Sundays, let's do this.
Dig it.
Speaking of which, this is not like a video game thing, but it's nerdy, so I did want to bring it up. We both went and saw Kong on Friday.
It was good.
A lot of fun. And then Samurai Jack premiere was last night. And, like, I know you're, like, not a Samurai Jack guy, but did you enjoy it?
I enjoyed it, yeah.
It's, oh, my God.
Oh, my God, that robot is, like, my spirit animal.
Dude, yeah, that villain was so great. And just, like, oh, I'm just so happy to see that show come back, man. Like, I'm such a big fan of Jendi's work. And, like, Samurai Jack is just so, like... I don't know, you were saying something about it last night where it's, like, it's one of the, like...
I think it's, like, the only serious adult animation, like, series we have in the West.
That's,
like... you know, cartoons for adults are generally sitcoms. You got your Bobs, yeah. your American Dads, your Family Guys, your Simpsons, your
Archer,
your Flintstones.
Sure. And it's like, it's not humorous. It's not.
It's like in, you know, a serious action cartoon. That's
yeah.
cool.
It's really cool.
Jack has always looked like Keanu Reeves a little bit.
A little bit, yeah.
And definitely more so now with the John Wick beard.
With the beard, yeah. He just looks like a strung out John Wick, basically. But, yeah, I mean, like, the big thing for me is just, like, I just love the artistry of it. Like, the animation is beautiful, and, like, its use of silence, you know, and, like, how many episodes there are of that show that have almost no dialogue and are just, like, ambient noise and stuff like that are really...
It's very cool.
It's very tasteful. So, yeah, if you're sleeping on either of those things, go check them out. We enjoyed them. So
yeah.
Just wanted to give a shout-out to those things. All right, so we're going to move on to the news. So...
The news! Please talk about the news! The news! We talk about the news! The news! I shouldn't be this out! The news! Put that on the ground!
Nice! That was good, man. I almost lost my glasses, and then I got way too into the beatboxing. It was a little intense.
Pete the beatbox, Imbesi.
Alright, guys, so I think we've got about 10 items on the list this week. So, we got a couple bits of Switch news that we're going to get into. So, item number one on the list is the Nintendo Switch's library. Got its first batch of new games this past week. We've got 8 new games to choose from if you're on the Switch, which a couple of them are new. Most of them are old, though. So, the first one, which I'm most excited about, is called Blaster Master Zero. We talked about it last week. It's kind of an homage to, like, NES shoot-em-ups kind of game, 8-bit aesthetic, retro gameplay kind of thing. Exclusive to the Switch and the 3DS for $9.99, so if you're a Nintendo fan, go check that out. We got 6 Neo Geo ports on the system.
None of them are good, except Metal Slug 3.
Yeah, it's like not really anything worth checking out. Nom 1975, King of Fighters 98, Waku Waku 7, Metal Slug 3, World Heroes Perfect, and Shock Troopers, all of which you can pick up for $8.
Just, you know, I can't oversell Metal Slug 3 if you're looking to play like a side-scrolling Contra kind of thing.
Is that good?
It's so good.
Maybe I'll bring it up.
Metal Slug 3 is a fantastic game.
I wonder if they've got 2-player on it.
Maybe.
That'd be cool.
Probably work with the Joy-Cons.
Yeah, that'd be cool. Maybe I'll pick it up. We'll do like a LP for Rewind or something.
Cool.
Okay, and then the last game is kind of anomalous. It's spelled all capital VOEZ, so those, I guess. It's a rhythm game for $25. It's got over 100 songs to play through, and it has a story about high school students. It was apparently getting a good amount of buzz a while ago before the Switch release, so not exactly my thing, but...
I'm not super into rhythm games anymore.
Yeah, me neither.
Hardcore Rock Band back in the day.
That was it, though. You know, it's like, I was really into Rock Band and Guitar Hero for a minute, but, you know, that's kind of come and gone for me, so...
We lost Pete!
Okay, so, if you guys remember, if you watched the show last week, which if not, please go check it out. We had our first impressions on the Nintendo Switch, Zelda, and Horizon, so you can go check that stuff out. We had friend of the show, Mike McMahon, on, so it was a good episode. But last week, we mentioned how a lot of Nintendo Switch owners are experiencing issues with the Joy-Con that causes the left one, right?
Yes.
The left one to desync whenever there is, like, kind of any interference between the controller and the console itself. So take a walk with me on this one. It's a little bit to unpack, but we've got a bit of an explanation as to what's going on here. So this is definitely the most widespread concern that we've seen about the Switch, but this desync issue, Nintendo suggested on a page that they put out that it could just be like wireless interference, so like could be other Bluetooth devices interfering mm-hmm. with it or anything like that. But that seems to not be the case, thanks to a breakdown from this YouTuber named John Doney, who goes by Spawnwave Media on YouTube. You can go check out his video, which we'll link to below, where he took apart both the Joy-Con controllers in an attempt to kind of understand what the differences were between them and why it was just the left that was having this issue where the right seemed to be fine. And it's worth noting that the right Joy-Con has some extra components, like an NFC chip and an infrared camera. But what he realized was that there's actually a, inside the left Joy-Con, there's a standalone antenna that, like, works for the Bluetooth signal, and it's being blocked by, a pretty substantial piece of metal, as well as your hand when you're holding it. So what he did in this video was he cracks it open, and does a light solder job and was able to rewire it and move it so it wasn't being blocked. And was actually able to increase the range of the Joy-Con up to about 30 feet, which is pretty impressive and far longer than the other one that doesn't have those same issues. So it's unfortunate that it seems like this is definitely a hardware issue. This is an issue that is not going to be able to be fixed with software. Hopefully later iterations of the console will be able to, you know, move past this issue. But the bright side, I guess, is that if you're bold, there seems to be a fix for it.
Yeah.
You want to save yourself some money.
I'm sure Nintendo is already working on, like, a new wave of Joy-Cons that don't have this problem, and it sucks. But that's, like, the realities of buying a console day one is just going to be unforeseen, you know. I don't want to call it minor, but, like, in the scale of things, it's relatively minor.
I think so. Like, I mean, it's easy for me to say because I'm one of the people who's lucky enough to not have any problems with my Switch, but... Like, ultimately, like, we talked about this off camera the other day. We were eating lunch. Like, how often are...
Like, nobody's launch is flawless.
Yeah.
And it's like, if this is the biggest hardware issue there is...
It's not that big a deal. Like, how often is this really happening to you anyway? You know, like...
Absolutely.
I know, like, friend of the show, Mike McMahon, like, he has the desync issue on his Joy-Con, but it's like... In a general living room, like, how often are you sitting far away, more than 6 feet away from the console? How often are something coming and standing in front of you long enough to fuck up that, you know, that sensor? Yeah. And to his point, it's actually really easy to resync just because the Switch has a very clear, like, you push a button and then hit L and it resyncs. So it's like, yeah, it's a problem. I'm not defending it. Like, it sucks, but, like...
But it's not the end of the world.
No, it's not as big as, like, the dead pixels and other things that people claim to be having. But, you know, it's also, like, I have doubts about the legitimacy of some of those things because, like, the whole... brouhaha about people complaining about their screens getting scratched by the dock. I'm pretty sure that's only happening if you're functionally, like, you know, like, brain damaged. You know, like, there's a solid quarter inch between the screen and the dock. And, like, unless you're putting it in and out at an angle, I don't see how you're scratching your
screen. Like, especially if you put a fucking screen protector on, like, you should be doing with any piece of electronics you have.
And they cost, like, $6.
Yeah.
Like, just get a screen protector. You know, it's like, or, I don't know, I'm inclined to think that those people have scratched their screens and then are then... blaming it on the dock.
Yeah.
And, like, not...
And, like...
maliciously or not, but...
Like, dead pixels suck, but also...
They happen.
They happen, and, like, three dead pixels in a Switch screen isn't a big deal.
No, and, like, it sucks. I would be really mad if that was the case, but, like, again, like you said this, it's kind of like, this is what you do when you buy new tech. Like, you are a beta tester.
It's, like, any, like...
Screen.
Any screen, any batch of them is gonna have, like, a handful of dead pixel screens. And, like, it sucks if you get one of those, but...
It's life.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, like, I'm not defending Nintendo on that one, but it's kind of just, like, this is what you kind of sign up for when you get new hardware. You know, it's like, people really, like, they quickly forget that, like, PS3s used to burn holes in people's floors. Mm-hmm. That was the thing. Like, Thompson had one of those faulty lasers where it was... on an angle, and it melted the bottom of his PS3.
That's awesome.
So, like, you know, it's like, you know, take it with a grain of salt, man, you know? And the vast majority of users do not seem to be having these problems, you know? I know of everyone I know who owns a Switch, Mike is the only one that has any of the three major issues that have been plaguing them. So,
right.
Worth considering there. So, another major issue that Nintendo Switch seems to be, or some users seem to be encountering, is a weak Wi-Fi signal. So, Switch owners in places like GameFAQ forums, NeoGAF, and Reddit are all talking about how they're getting a lot of slow internet speeds, causing long buffering times, and inability to connect to the eShop, all kinds of stuff like that. So, what this seems to be doing, or what this seems to be coming from anyway, is actually the Switch's networking chip. So, according to iFixit's breakdown of the console, the Switch is using a Broadcom BCM4356... chip, which supports 802.11 AC Wi-Fi on a 2.4 gigahertz and 5 gigahertz bands, which should make for high speeds but can lead to a reduced range. And the frequency is very popular with a lot of wireless devices, so that could also lead to a lot of interference.
I mean, those are the two big bands. You got your 2.4 and your 5.
Yeah. So the combination of the decreased range with the competition it's experiencing from other devices seems to be causing these issues. I will say anecdotally, I had these issues with the day I set up my Switch. I spent about an hour and a half troubleshooting it, and that really was annoying. I think I talked about that last week. where I had trouble getting connected to the eShop. I wasn't able to connect to my new Nintendo account. It was just weird. But once I got, like, I went and actually Nintendo mentions this on their FAQ. They say while troubleshooting, if possible, their solution is to move the Switch 10 to 15 feet closer to the router. That doesn't seem to be solving the problem for many people where they're still experiencing very, very low or bad connectivity. But in my experience, I was able to undock my Switch, go and sit next to my router, troubleshoot, connect to the internet, and then ever since then, I've had no problems.
Awesome.
So that's anecdotal. I hope that Nintendo will be able to figure this out with firmware or something, and that it isn't just that these cards are fucked and that, like, all these Generation Switches are going to have this problem, or that every Switch will have this problem moving forward. But, you know, we'll update you with more information as it comes in. That's kind of all we know right now. And if you are one of the people affected by this, let us know in the comments below. Hit us up and let us know how it's going for you. I know a friend of the show, Jared Wagner, has been complaining about the same issues. But I'm going to call him out because I know he doesn't watch this specific show.
Yeah.
He's not playing his Switch, so it's really easy to complain about hardware issues when you're not
going to his house and take it and play Zelda and give it back to him.
You should, because, like, he's playing Horizon. He's like, I'm going to finish Horizon before I play Zelda. I'm just like, oh,
no, you're not.
How are you doing that? Like, okay, anyway. A little bit of good news for the Switch is the Switch is experiencing the strongest launch of any Nintendo console in the Americas and Europe, and is also doing pretty well in Japan. So, a report from the New York Times writer Nick Wingfeld claims that the Nintendo Switch is already a massive success for Nintendo. Nintendo hasn't thrown out any exact numbers yet, but he had an interview with Reggie, who's the president of Nintendo of America, and he told Wingfeld that, that it trounced Wii U sales in the Americas, and then actually ended up outpacing the Wii to become the console's best launch in America.
How much of that, though, is because they just didn't make enough Wiis? The world may never
We're
have.
Getting to that. Oh. Don't worry. according to Wingfeld, Reggie also noted that Breath of the Wild is the console's best standalone launch game, beating out Super Mario 64 and even Wii Sports, which was a pack-in game. So that's huge. Speaks volumes about how many people are playing Zelda right now. And then Nintendo has followed up and said that the Switch has also replicated that success in Europe. So they put out a press release where they said that it has, quote, sold more in its launch weekend than any other Nintendo hardware in history, and that, again, Breath of the Wild is the best-selling launch title as well. So it's worth noting here that we don't have specific sales figures, but we do know that in the first 6 days the Wii was on market, it sold 600,000 units. So the Switch is already above that, at least, in America. Don't know about Europe. But without having more sales figures, and with the caveat of the fact that, like, Nintendo did have a controlled drip of Wiis, like, that does kind of color this information a bit.
Wasn't the number they made... Oh, shit, we're way out of focus. Wasn't the number for...
sorry about that. Don't know how long that was.
For Switch production, they made 2 million worldwide and... Basically, they all sold out.
I'm pretty sure that's the number, yeah.
Yeah.
So,
and, like, you can't find a Switch right now.
Nowhere.
Unless you're buying from a scalper.
Yeah,
or
they're
standing
nowhere.
At a Target at 6 o'clock in the
morning. Exactly. And even that, like, it's, you know...
Hit and miss.
Yeah, it's totally hit and miss. So, and the numbers that they have at those stores are, like,
you know,
20!
Like,
maybe!
You know, 3 are coming in our truck today, guys.
Yeah. You get here at 6 in the morning, maybe you'll get one.
Yep.
I mean, like, no matter what, like, even with that grain of salt, like, these numbers are impressive, and it's a solid launch for the Switch, which is great, because, obviously, we had our doubts. So that's good. Not as important, but in Japan, we do have a little more specific numbers, which make this interesting. The Switch sold 313,000 units in its first 48 hours on sale, which, put it just above the Wii U at 308,000. But it is also worth noting that Japan's console market has been on the decline for the last, like, 10 years. So, like, these numbers aren't super surprising.
Yeah.
And, you know, when we do see bigger, more resonant software come out, I'm sure those numbers will move. When we see the first, like, Fire Emblem, Monster Hunter, Mario, games that really resonate in Japan, I think, you know, not that Zelda doesn't, but, you know, we've talked before about the kind of, I think, massaged, like, importance of Zelda because of its cultural relevance to gamers versus its actual sales. So, when we see some of those more Japanese-centric titles come out, I think we'll start to see some Switches move there. Because, you know, this, I think this console really speaks to the Japanese gamer's lifestyle. Oh, you know? Like,
like, if it can establish itself as a handheld, too.
Yeah, right. And, like, be a handheld first, home console for them second.
Yeah.
I think. Whereas we'll probably see the opposite in the States.
Opposite?
I'm all over the place with my pronunciations today. I don't know. But, yeah. So, good. I'm emboldened by this. I think if you're, if you got a Switch, if you're thinking about getting a Switch, but you're worried about install bases and how that's going to affect users and stuff, I mean, like, we're off to a good start here. So, you know.
Buy a Switch and then play Splatoon. So they make Splatreen.
Join our Splatoon team. We're definitely going to do that, by the way. Like, that's happening. You, me, Thompson, Mike McMahon, Jared Wagner, we're a Splatoon team. It's happening.
Squid kids.
Squid. Are you a squid? Are you a kid? Are you a squid? Are you a kid?
All right, moving on.
Okay. So, despite the fact that Zelda has been a top one seller in most places around the world, Horizon Zero Dawn managed to edge it out in the UK as the number one best-selling title on the week of release in March 4th. So, Horizon Zero Dawn took the number one spot, Breath of the Wild came in at number two, then we had Grand Theft Auto 5 still at number three somehow. I don't know how people still don't own this game. Like, I feel like, aren't we running out of human beings to buy Grand Theft Auto 5?
I guess if, like, you know, you bought a new console this week.
Yeah, I guess. But then
you really wanted to experience Trevor again.
Yeah, right. So, I'm not going to read the whole top 10, but it's worth noting then again that 1-2 Switch came in at number 4, For Honor was at number 5, and then we saw Super Bomberman R at number 7. So, really cool to see three Nintendo Switch titles on this list.
Mostly really cool to see Rocket League still at number 8.
Yeah, Rocket League's still fucking trucking along, which is...
I love that game.
Rocket League is amazing. If you haven't played Rocket League yet, go check out our Let's Play of it. Go buy it. It's fucking phenomenal. And
isn't Jesse in that Let's Play?
No? No, it's me and Thompson.
Oh, it's you and Thompson? Yeah, okay, yeah. I remember that was like way back in the day.
That's a super old one. That's like the second one we ever shot, I think. You know how you know it's really old? It's like...
Because, like, you watch it and you're like, God, I was bad at Rocket League.
That's true. And also, I captured all of it using my PlayStation 4 share feature. So it's that old. Yeah. yeah, so this is just cool to mention because, A, I love Horizon. I mean, it's not super surprising because we've talked about it before in the past about how Sony is very dominant in the UK because Nintendo totally ignores the European market. But, I love Horizon. I love the Switch. I'm really happy to see these things putting up numbers, so wanted to celebrate them. Yeah. So, speaking of PlayStation, Naughty Dog has confirmed that another Uncharted game from them is very unlikely. So, in an interview with Game Informer, which we'll link to down below, Naughty Dog confirmed that The Lost Legacy, which is the upcoming Uncharted story DLC starring Chloe and Nadine, will almost certainly be the final entry in the franchise for Naughty Dog. So we have a quote here that says, quote, I would say that Naughty Dog doing an Uncharted after this is very unlikely. This is from Evan Wells, who's the co-founder and president of the studio. He said, I would, quote, never say never, but The Last of Us 2 Part 2 on our plates, and there's so many other projects we'd like to explore. We really love the franchise, but the studio has limited resources and lots of other ideas. So I think this is a good thing. I mean, I love Uncharted. I love The Last, or not The Last of Us. I love the idea that they're coming back to The Last of Us, but, like, Naughty Dog is, for my money, one of the, like, all-time great developers out there. And, like, this team, specifically, like, Naughty Dog will exist beyond this team, but this team of developers that have been assembled for a long time only has so many games in them.
Oh, yeah.
And we're starting to see that talent retire and move, which we're going to talk about in a minute. So, like, them moving on to do a new idea is way more exciting to me than them giving me more of something that I already like.
Yeah, I'm like, I think this is a win for the defranchisation of games.
Yeah.
Where it's like, it's a thing that we're definitely seeing in movies and we're starting to see in games where it's just like, everything's a fucking sequel.
Or built with the expectation of it becoming a franchise.
Yeah.
Which is equally problematic in my mind.
Yeah, and I would love to see a game that just, like, you know, like The Last of Us. I guess now it has a sequel, but...
Yeah.
Just stands on its own. It's like, yeah, we probably aren't going to come back to this. This is what we have to say.
And that's it.
That's it.
Or, like, if you do decide to go the route of sequelization to have an endpoint in mind.
Yeah.
You know, like, again, like, no, like being like, Uncharted 4 is it. That's the end of Nate's story. We're done. We're going to move on. You know? And, like, if we get another Uncharted in the future by someone else, cool. Like, that'd be fine. I mean, like, Uncharted 4 is definitely the end of Nate's story, but I talked about it months and months ago, it very clearly sets up a possible future for the franchise with different characters that are related in some way. I won't spoil those things, yeah. But it would be a natural progression. So it's like if Sony has some other studio that they want to give it to that's like, you know, one of their incubator studios that they want to give a chance to do something bigger or whatever, that could be cool, but yeah. Or not. Because Uncharted ended and it's done. And I'm fine with that. You know, like, move on.
Yeah.
So I'm glad to see this. I'm really excited for, it has a name somewhere.
The Lost Legacy?
The Lost Legacy. I'm really excited for The Lost Legacy, but I'm totally content with that being it for Uncharted.
Yeah.
Like, Uncharted 4 was good enough. And, like, the fact that I'm going to get a little bit more and get to wrap up Chloe's story, hopefully, that's really all I need, cool. You know? So, yeah, excited to see what's next from Naughty Dog.
Speaking of Naughty Dog's talent, moving on.
Oh, yeah, here we go. So, Naughty Dog's co-president, Christoph Balestra? Balestra, I believe?
Slash Bond villain.
Yeah, Christoph Bond villain, is leaving Naughty Dog after 15 years. So, he was the co-president and co-founder, and he announced that he's going to be leaving after 15 years with the company in a goodbye post on their website, which you can go check out below. We got a short quote to pull from here. Where he said, quote, "It's very challenging to come to the realization that it's time to step away from a career to pursue fulfilling personal ambitions and projects. I'm doing it, I'm doing it now out of the utmost respect for the team and their unwavering dedication to Naughty Dog and our projects. The time has come for me to now spend more time with my family and to create a void to see what I can fill with it, which will obviously involve programming." So, you know, we wish Christoph the best of luck. And, you know, thanks for all your hard work, man, over the past 15 years at Naughty Dog. You made some of my favorite games, and I'm excited to see what you have next.
Yeah.
And even if it's just you're chilling out and enjoying time with your family, God bless, man. You're
good. You, man.
Yeah. So, I mean, hopefully we'll get a fun indie game from him in the future, though.
Naughty Dog, what they do isn't necessarily for me, but they do it very well.
I think they do it what they do better than anybody else.
Yeah. And it's like, I'm not the biggest fan of what they do, but Uncharted 2 is basically perfect.
Yeah, I would agree with that sentiment. Best of luck, man.
Yeah.
So, item number 8 on the list is Mass Effect Andromeda's latest trailer. Gave a clue that we might be seeing some Koreans finally, which is something we've talked about a couple times. So, the new Andromeda trailer titled Golden Works rolled out a couple days ago, and it mentions Habitat 5 being a perfect home for the mission's Korean colonists. So, at about 2 minutes and 10 seconds into the video, we get a direct quote where it says, "For Arturian and Korean colonists, Habitat 5 appears to be a perfect home for dextroprotein life." Or protein life, excuse me.
That's cool.
Not confirmation that we'll definitely have a Korean team member or anything, but it seems to confirm that Koreans are at least a part of this mission. They're one of the races, council races, involved in the Andromeda exploration. So we'll probably see some of them over the course of the game, or in maybe a sequel or something like that. So.
Mass Effect Trilogy 2, I guess?
Yeah, I don't...
Seems to be what they're building for?
Yeah, I mean, like, I guess it's gonna just be Andromeda 2, Andromeda 3, like,
maybe.
I'd be fine with that. So, yeah, I'm excited about this. I like the Koreans. I like the Geth. I hope
Mass
see
Effect up as a trilogy of trilogies, right? It's Mass Effect, then it's the Andromeda trilogy.
And then we get one that moves forward.
Then we get one that's a prequel trilogy.
They should do that. I've been saying it for a year. First Contact Wars, baby, let's do it. I would play the shit out of that game. Okay, so item number 9 on the list is Overwatch has given another little win for diversity representation. So we've gotten a fan theory that's been rolling around about Symmetra, finally confirmed by one of Blizzard's... it's from Jeff Kaplan, who's the director of Overwatch. So basically, a long-running fan theory about Symmetra was that she was somewhere on the autistic spectrum. That has since been confirmed when one astute fan wrote in to Blizzard and was basically asking for confirmation on this based on a hint that had been seen in one of the Overwatch comics. Jeff Kaplan wrote him back and was like, "Yeah, good job, astute viewer, you figured it out." So in his response, one of the quotes was, quote, "It's very astute of you to notice she mentioned the spectrum in our comic. Symmetra is autistic, and she's one of our most beloved heroes, and we think she does a great job of representing just how awesome someone with autism can be." So,
my only question is she one of their most beloved heroes? Like,
I think he means them. Like, the creative team. Yeah. I mean, like, I think this is great. We've talked about this before when they announced that Tracer was gay. Like, there's a lot of people who are butthurt about this for, like, seemingly no reason. A lot of people, like, seeming to take the posture of, why does this matter? It doesn't have anything to do with the game. Like, the story isn't part of the game in that way. Why do we have to, like, be all PC about it or whatever? It's like, honestly, like, fuck you. Okay? Like, I'm sorry. I'm jumping up on my soapbox here. Like, you're a fucking asshole if you feel that way. Like, there are millions and millions of games starring white, hetero, cis dudes for you to identify with. If you're really that fucking mad that you can't fap to Tracer anymore because she's a lesbian or that Symmetra is autistic, grow the fuck up. Sorry. Peace. That's my 2 cents for the day. So, yeah. I think this is great for autistic gamers out there to have a character that they can relate to, you know? So, fucking, yeah. Good stuff, man.
All right, so we got some quick hits.
Yeah, item number 10 is going to be a wrap-up this week. So, again, if you want full versions of these stories, go check everything in the description below. Quote, 1 year from today, he's going to wreck it again.
I'm going to wreck it.
We got a sequel for Wreck-It Ralph 2 coming out. Supposed to be out literally about a year from this today. So it's March 9th, 2018 is the release date for the movie right now. Not too much else about it. We got a poster, showed some allusions to the real world, which maybe that's going to be a plot point, who knows. But, yeah, the big thing for me that I remember is, like, they have loosely confirmed that Mario is going to be in this one, finally. Because I know that was, like, the thing they struggled to get him in the first game. So, I'm excited to see what other cameos they get into this. I would like to see a real video game character play a slightly bigger role. I think that would be fun.
But I understand if they don't want to do that.
I think that's totally fair, too.
I really did enjoy the bad guy support group.
That was such a good bit.
That was just, like, the best scene in that movie.
Just because you're a bad guy doesn't mean you're a bad guy.
I fucking love that they got fucking Zangief.
Yes! Great, man. And, you know, just like little nods like Hubert and stuff like that were a lot of fun. So I don't think we need like a big thing, but it would be cool if there was like a like turning point moment and like Mario hooks him up with a magic mushroom or something. Just a nice little nod, like that'd be cool, you know? So we'll see what happens. Either way, I'm looking forward to it. So, next one is, we got some first screenshots from Marvel's Guardians of the Galaxy and, a blog post that gave us the main voice cast. We've got Scott Porter as Star-Lord, Emily O'Brien as Gamora, Nolan North as Rocket Raccoon, Brandon Paul Eilis as Drax, and Adam Harrington as Groot. So, pretty fucking great cast there.
That's a solid cast, yeah. A
couple people they've worked with in the past, which is cool. Like, I feel like Telltale's really starting to kind of, like, get a, like, stable of, like, voice actors that they like to work with. Like, we've seen almost all these people in previous Telltale
games. I mean, that's not saying much. Nolan North's in literally every game.
That's true. But, I mean, like, the guy, what is it? Adam Harrington from Groot, who's Groot? He was Bigby.
Oh, that's cool.
And I think Drax was one of the other main characters in a previous episode as well. So,
I am Groot.
I am Groot. Yeah, it's like, it's really good. It's like, oh, cool, Bigby's back. He's going to say I am Groot like 50 times. But that's fine. It's probably a good pick. He had that, like, good, rough, gravelly kind of
toad.
Yeah, so I could see him nailing that. So I'm really excited for that game. And, like, if you guys are fans of the show, you know I'm a huge Telltale fan in general. And, like, I love the Guardians. I'm really excited to see the Marvel relationship that they announced, like, fucking 4 years ago, like, finally come to fruition. So, this is gonna be an exciting
one. Fun.
The Guardians are a good fit for this. Last item on the list is something we're both super excited about. Steven Universe has a original RPG coming to consoles.
I think it's just the PS4.
Is it?
I think.
Has that since been confirmed?
I think that has been confirmed since this article broke the other day.
So, maybe we don't know. This was
it's
an old
definitely game. Gonna be on PS4.
Definitely.
Yes.
Yeah, and this article I'm pulling from, it's actually worth mentioning, did come out before
like the actual announcement, right?
And before PAX, and then there's one of the big development weeks in California happened last week.
Yeah.
Like
EGC or something?
VGCs, something like that. So there was like a ton of indie games being shown off at those events.
You talk about this, I will Google and
thank you. And Steven, I think, was shown at that. So what we do know, while Andy looks up the rest, is this is gonna be a it's coming to consoles, like we said, coming out in the summer. It's gonna be developed by Grumpy Face Studios and is supposed to appeal to both diehard fans of Steven Universe and newcomers. It's a follow-up to, or a sequel to, Attack the Light, which was an action role-playing game that was, like, really well-received. You liked it. Yeah, it's good. It's like a little...
It's like an action-like game on your phone, right?
If Steven was Paper Mario.
Okay, cool. So it's like a light action RPG kind of thing?
Yep.
Maybe I'll have to check that out. So I think that was on mobile, right?
Yep.
Okay, so yeah, you can check that out on iPhone and Android. But yeah, so Save the Light is going to have an original story from Rebecca Sugar, who's the creator of Steven Universe, that deals with Steven and the Crystal Gems trying to find a magical weapon when it's stolen from Beach City. And it looks like it's got, like, a similar kind of, like, real-time, like, turn-based mm-hmm. action kind of thing going on. We've seen some screenshots of it. It looks super adorable. It has a very, like, simplistic kind of Paper Mario style 2D sprites.
Yeah. So, definitely confirmed for
PS4 only?
No.
Okay.
Sony, right on the PlayStation blog, it's like, it will be on PS4 this year.
Okay, cool.
Haven't announced a release date. They've just talked about, like, the team at Grumpy Box and Grumpy Face, and Steven Universe have just said consoles.
Okay.
So
it's like a real game.
Yeah, it's like a real game. Other things they confirmed this weekend was there's going to be 8 playable characters.
Okay. I know in the promotional material, we saw Steven, the 3 main gems, Connie and Greg.
Yeah.
So I'm Lion, maybe?
Lion.
Or Lattice and Peridot.
Yeah.
That would do it.
Yep.
Yeah, Aladdin's actually probably like a summoner or something.
Probably.
Lapis and Peridot would make sense.
Cool.
Yeah, so
I'm excited for this game.
I'm really excited.
There's a trailer, too, somewhere.
Oh, there's a trailer? Awesome.
Somewhere? It says, this link I had. Yep, gameplay reveal trailer at Gematsu.
Cool, we'll watch that later. Cool. And we'll link that to that below as well with the rest of the stuff. So, definitely very excited for that.
Due out this summer.
Cool. Yeah, expect a lot more updates on that when they come.
I'll stream the whole game.
Yeah, no, I was going to say, we will do the entire thing. Like, yeah. I'm so in for that.
I'll wear my Steven Universe bro tech.
Andy, that's the perfect time to launch our Steven Universe podcast I've been trying to get you to do for years. All right, guys. So, I really badly want to make a Slack and Slash production Steven Universe podcast called Keep Beach City Weird with me, Andy, and his sister, Laura. And I think it would be the new flagship show, man. Way better than our Dragon Ball Z podcast. I'll tell you that much.
This is our Dragon Ball Z podcast.
All right,
topic of the show, why does Piccolo suck so much?
I literally had to refrain myself from slapping you in the face just now. Unacceptable.
Last night we were watching Dragon Ball Super after Samurai Jack, which is, like, fucking ridiculous Dragon Ball Super, by the way.
And then they played Kai right afterwards. I'm like, God, I miss Adult Swim.
Yeah. But I was saying, I feel bad for Piccolo and Vegeta. I'm not sure who I feel worse for in the, like, structure of a Dragon Ball arc. Because Vegeta is basically the second most powerful being there's ever been by 6 inches.
Every time.
And Piccolo, like, the structure of a Dragon Ball arc goes, you know, thing shows up. Piccolo is the most powerful of them all at a point. It beats the shit out of Piccolo, and Goku's like, I gotta get stronger. It just beat up Piccolo.
Pretty much.
Then Goku and Vegeta both, like, encounter some, like, new level of being a Super Saiyan. Then Piccolo just absorbs another Namekian to keep up.
See, like, the reason I don't feel bad for Piccolo, though, is, like, he's just above it, man. Like, he doesn't care about being the strongest, you know? It's like, he, like, has a very pragmatic, like, use of, like, the purpose of getting stronger is to protect the planet that I live on. It's like, cool. Like, I don't know. I just got nothing but respect for Piccolo. He's a good dad. He protects the planet. And also, like, I feel like he's, like, a very... I mean, Goku's like this, too. I guess so is Vegeta. Yeah. Like, that's kind of the whole thing of Dragon Ball. But it's, like, they're so motivated by self-interest and pride. Whereas, like, Piccolo very much... to me, feels more like a Superman character of, like, a Earth's my planet because I adopted it, you know?
Goku doesn't, you know, I don't think he's always motivated by self-interest and pride. It's like, yeah, he gets stronger because, like, he's a dick and just loves fighting.
The spirit of competition. Yeah, that's fair.
And Vegeta, definitely. Vegeta, everything he does is motivated by pure straight hatred, and that's why I identify him.
Anyway, this isn't a Dragon Ball Z podcast, so we're going to move over to the meat and potatoes today, and I just kind of wanted to do a follow-up on last week's topic.
Where you have takes about Zelda that you want to share now that you're a little farther into Zelda?
Yeah, I've got hot takes on Zelda and the Switch in general. Basically, to help
guide me, though. I was hoping that you might, like, help lead the discussion a little bit. Okay. I'll get out my you know, tentpole thoughts, and then you give me some follow-up questions, and we'll try to shape the conversation a little bit. So, I mean, my main takeaway from it is I am starting to get the feeling that this might be my favorite Zelda game. And, like, that's a really weighted statement, especially because, like, so much of my relationship to Zelda has to do with things that are also, like, personal, you know, mm-hmm. and not just, like, the game itself is great. And I think, like, what I'm feeling about this is, like, it has every single one of those aesthetic or emotional things that I need to connect with Zelda, but then it's also delivering a totally new experience that feels head and shoulder above anything they've done in a really long time.
Really?
Yeah, like, really long time. It's just so mechanically tight and thought out in so many ways. Like, again, the combat's a little shaky at times, but, like, other than that, like, the physics of the world and stuff like that, the amount of thought that seems to be put into how you're going to interact with things, how you're going to discover things, and not just, like, things. Like, not just, like, I'm going to walk over this cliff and find, like, where the Zoras are, and that's amazing. Like, more like, I didn't know that I had a parry ability until I did it, you know? Cool. Or I didn't know that I could, I didn't know I could use a Coco as a weapon until I tried, you know, and stuff like that. And the fact that the game doesn't have a Navi or, you know, a, whatever the character from Skyward Sword is, the sword lady.
Yeah.
A character like that, every time I get to a new area, being like, you can go here, you can do this, you can do that. It's like, every time I discover something, I'm like, oh, wow. Like, you get that, like, quintessential aha moment that, like, makes Legend of Zelda so good is, like, every 5 fucking minutes in this game. You know? It's like, I'm constantly having an aha moment, you know?
Okay.
And, like, that is so, it's just so good. It's so enamoring, man. It's so refreshing to, like, play a Zelda game that feels so essential again.
That's really cool. So I guess my first question that's been kind of bugging me about the whole, like, Zelda goes open thing.
Yeah.
Is, you've played Link Between Worlds, right?
Mm-hmm.
Link Between Worlds is whole, like, it's whole, you can do the temples in any order vibe.
Almost anywhere, yeah.
Yeah. Was, like, it was weird for me because it didn't feel, I don't feel like the sense of growth felt as satisfying.
Yeah, I totally get that.
Is that still present in Breath of the Wild?
No. And I totally know what you mean, because I personally thought that the whole system of, like, buying or renting weapons and being able to do anything in any order, like, did kind of take the wind out of my sails a little bit, because I didn't feel like I was getting any stronger. You know? But what's really cool about Breath of the Wild is it kind of does the same thing in that very early on it gives you all of the tools that you're ever going to have, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, you'll find better weapons, you'll find weapons that have new abilities. Like, I've seen stuff from people who are way further in the game than me where they have, like, fire wands that they can use to cast fire spells or freeze people with stuff, like,
mm-hmm.
shit like that. But ultimately, like, the Sheikah Slate is your power set, and you unlock all the powers of the Sheikah Slate basically by the end of the tutorial, which is about, I would say, 2 or 3 hours, probably. But you don't know it's a tutorial, you know? Like, it doesn't really feel like a tutorial. It's not like a learn how, it's like, go here, go here, go here, learn and unlock these skills, then we're gonna really just let you, like, out, you know?
Okay.
So you're kind of, like, in this little, you get one, like, segment of the map that you're not able to leave. And you have to go to all the different trials there, and that's how you fill out your Sheikah Slate, and then you get the glider thing that you can use to explore,
mm-hmm.
and that's when you're able to leave. And from that point on, that problem is alleviated, I think, because none of the things are, like, progression-based, if that makes sense. Like, the trials, right? Like,
yeah.
Each trial is unique and not related to another trial. So it's not like I've got this ability, I learned how to use it, now I need to learn a new way to use it or something like that. Or I guess it is more that, but not in a way that's, like, directed. You know what I mean? Like, it's not like you unlock the bomb, right?
Right.
So use the bomb in this specific way to solve this specific puzzle, and now go to the next one, and we're going to teach you a new way to use it. It's like, well, that is what happens, but they don't do it that way. It's not like a, you can use the bombs this way. It's like, you're in this thing, here's a puzzle, figure it out.
Okay.
And it's not ever like, it's not always apparent exactly what you're supposed to do, you know? So it's like, you might have the inclination, oh, I know I need to use my time stop power here, but how do I do what it needs me to do, you know? Or like, I see what I'm supposed to do, here's a bunch of disparate pieces in this room, put them together and solve the puzzle. And I love that because I never walk into an area thinking, oh, I gotta come back here when I have a different item, you know, or I gotta come back here when I have some new skill. It's like, no, test your wits, figure it out.
That, like, that sounds great and simultaneously, like, kind of bums me out.
Because you don't have that?
That's one of my, like, favorite things in games is, like, I love Metroid games and, like, Castlevania shit, and I love going back and being more powerful and just being like, oh, wait, this thing that caused me so much trouble, no, fuck you, I have items now.
Well, that still exists, though. It's just cool because of the way it happens, it's not... Like, the whole world is filled with things that are like that.
Okay.
So, like, a great example, right, is there's a lake in one of the first two segments of the map that you explore, right? Big-ass lake. And the first time I went there, I'm walking past it, and I'm just going somewhere. I'm trying to get to a waypoint on my map, and I just happen to be running alongside this body of water. I was like, whatever, I don't need to explore this right now. I'm doing something. And a boss just comes up from the ground. It's like this big rock golem deity kind of thing. And it's like the guardian of the lake. And it starts fucking annihilating me. And I'm just like, no! And it's like, ran the fuck away. And then now I'm still not at a point where I could fight it. But I see that I am getting there. Because when you go and do the trials, every time you beat a trial, you get a spirit orb.
Okay.
And when you get 4 spirit orbs, you have to go to a shrine. And then you can either get a new heart or an extension of your stamina bar.
Okay.
And both of those things obviously give you more combative ability. But also, as you advance through the game and go through, like, the bigger levels and deeper areas, you find better weapons and stuff like that, and that gives you a sense of progression.
Okay.
Because, like, I'm using this, you know, like, the place I'm at, the best weapons I have are all in the range of, like, 10 to 12, you know? And, like, they break really easy, and they're shitty. But, like, late game, you're finding weapons that are, like, in the 20s and 30s and are, like, way more durable.
Do you get a Master Sword at any point?
I don't know.
And, like, so...
I would assume so, but...
I know it's been, like, a thing that's talked up that, like, once you're done the tutorial, you can run straight for the last boss and fight him if you want to.
Yeah, apparently.
Is there, like, a sense of story?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. So, the broad... like, strokes of the story are, obviously, you're, like, so, there's, like, two narratives that intersect. So, like, the pre-narrative, I guess, that, like, is the setting stage for what is actually happening, is, this incarnation of Ganon is called Calamity Ganon. And it's, like, he's basically, like, Ganon meets Galactus from the bad Fantastic Four movie, where he's, like, a big cloud. And there's, like, a weird spectral Ganon that you see, but, like, I'm not really sure what that's going to mean.
Right.
So, it's one of the timelines where he's, like, a force more than a man, you know? Like, so he's obviously had some success. So, in this original proto-narrative or whatever, the Hylians and the Sheikah are, like, very close. The Sheikah are... they support the royal family, like, in Hyrule. Or, like, not in Ocarina is what I meant to say. And they have, like, advanced technology. That's where the Sheikah Slates come from and all this stuff. And then they discover this other, like, more ancient tech. And that's, like, the Guardians. Those, like, spider robots and stuff. And they also discovered these big, like, mechs that are basically just, like, Zords or, like, whatever. They're, like, different, like, animals.
Okay.
And so... like, is this whole, like, prophecy lore, like, kind of thing where each of them is piloted by a different, one of the different races. So there's a Zora pilot, the bird people from Wind Waker, Gorons, and Gerudos.
Okay.
And then, so, like, they found all this stuff. They start using it to defend Hyrule in the event that Ganon eventually attacks again, because obviously Ganon always fucking comes back. So the first time Ganon attacks, they're, like, ready to go. They have the four champions and the hero and Zelda, and, like, that, like, dream team beats Ganon and sends him away for another 10,000 years. And then they figure out that Ganon's coming back. So, like, all right, we got to do this again. We're going to get new champions and whatever. And, like, they just are not prepared enough. And Ganon, like, knows that that's what they're going to do. So Ganon takes over all of the spider bots and, like, uses them to fucking level Hyrule and, like, Kakariko and, like, all the... basically every single settlement except for, like, one of the villages that was behind the fort that Link was at.
Okay.
So he, like, defended that one fucking town is still around. And at that battle, like, all the champions die. Link is on the verge of death, and, they save him, and they go and throw him in this, like, Sheikah... it's that, like, big pool that you see him in that, like, drains out and wakes up. So then he wakes up after 100 years. That was, like, how long it took for them to, like, repair his body or whatever, because he was, like, so fucked up. Like, they tell the story and everything. It was, like, oh, it was this huge battle, and, like, the only reason it didn't fall is because he held the line and he gave his life, and... but some people say he survived or whatever.
The captain from Mass Effect?
Basically.
Hold the line.
Yeah, and it's like, he fucking does it, apparently. So then they get him, he's revived, he has no memory of anything, and, like, the setup is you have to go after you figure out everything.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, mild spoilers, there's this old man in the very beginning who ends up being the ghost of the King of Hyrule.
Okay.
And he sets you off on your adventure.
Does he give you a sword and say it's dangerous to go alone?
No. But he
goes, like, everything about this game feels like, what if we remade Zelda 1, but as, like, Skyrim?
That's very apparent, and, like, the old man thing is, like, that's what it is, but that being said, so then you set off, you go meet Impa, and she tells you all this.
Okay.
And then it's, like, go and find the champions, and but your main quest is still defeat Ganon. So I guess you could just run right there and fight him.
Yeah, no, there's, right now the any percent, speedrun record is 1 hour, 11 minutes.
Wow, holy shit.
Just, like, finish the tutorial, sprint at Ganon, kill Ganon.
That's cool. So yeah, so I'm, like, that's the thing is, like, the game gives you so much agency. There are often times where I catch myself being, like, what am I supposed to be doing right now? And I'm, like, oh, right, whatever I want. Like, it doesn't matter.
And, like, I know there's only the 4 big temples.
Yeah. And those are where you get the guardians.
Where,
I think.
Where I assume, yeah.
Yeah.
But are there, like, other quests and stuff?
It's the shrines are the big other thing where it's, like, there are over 100 shrines, so they're fucking everywhere. And then there are tons of side quests. And they range from things of, like, the first stable I encountered, where you can, like, board your horses and stuff. I ran into these two guys who were, like, brothers, and they're, like, talking about finding this treasure, but they have to, like, figure out this riddle, and then you have the riddle and the explanation of where they think it is. And no mark on your map or anything, it's just like, hey, it's, like, near this river, go check it out, and if you can figure it out, there's a treasure there.
That's cool.
So there's lots of stuff like that, that is just, like, vaguely kind of like, go find this thing, maybe, you know? And then there are other things.
That's super Majora's Mask-y.
Yeah, very Majora's
Mask. But it's, like, without the frustrating part of Majora's Mask, where you need to, like, talk to the person at the exact right time and, like,
follow them to the one point in the day where you need them. And it's great because it doesn't have any of that problem. And it I love that it's like, one of them, I was like, I want to go do this quest. So I set it the waypoint, and then it took me back to the person that gave me the quest. And I was like, oh, fuck, you're really not going to even give me a close approximation or
that's
anything.
That's, like, really cool.
Like, it makes it, it's not just a fetch quest.
Yeah.
You know, like, oh, and then the other thing to answer your question is there are also more driven side quests. Like, there's this one in that village I was talking about that's not fucked up. You can go there and, like, you can buy a house. There's a house that's getting torn down, and you'll be like, no, I'll buy it. And they're like, okay, give us 3,000 rupees. And then you can, like, decorate it and stuff. Like,
that's cool.
One of the things, like, I scanned my amiibo, because the amiibo support in this game is awesome. Like, if you scan the Link amiibo the first time, you summon the legit, like, real Epona. And you can only do it once.
Oh, that's cool.
So you can board her, and then, like, now I have real Epona, and, like, her, like, mane is, like, kind of, like, the lighting's a little weird on it, so it's, like, she, like, kind of glows.
That's cool.
And, like, she just seems very, like, legendary. And, like, you go to board her, and you're like, oh, that's the legendary horse Epona! Oh, my God! That's really cool. And then, like, I scanned my Toon Link amiibo, and I got a bunch of fish.
That's cool.
You know? But then you also get his boomerang.
Oh, nice.
And like boomerangs are like a common, semi-common like melee weapon, and you can use them as a sword. But you can also like, there's a thing where you can throw your weapons, right? So like you can have like spears and javelin on them or whatever, like whip your sword. But if you whip the boomerang, it goes, and then you can catch it. And if you don't catch it, it flies past you, and you have to go find it.
That's really cool. But it's awesome. I saw in Donkey's video, they can catch your boomerangs too.
Yeah, yeah. Other enemies can catch your boomerang and shit. So, but the cool thing, like, so I bought the house, and then like you get like a weapon mount. So, like I mounted like the boomerang on the wall once it gets to the point where it's like ready to break, you know?
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, cool. So I can like show off these cool weapons, you know?
That's dope.
And then there's other like weird things where like in that same town, I met this guy who's like in love with this woman who like works the inn. And, like, he's like, she never talks to me, like, I want to get her a gift, but, like, what, like, I don't know what to get her. So, like, you go and talk to her, and, like, you have to go behind the desk to talk to her, and she's like, what are you doing? Like, can I help you? Like, and you're just like, oh, like, what do you like? And she's just like, ah, like, I gotta get rid of this guy. Like, what do you mean, what do I like? It's like, why are you talking to me? And she's like, I want 100 jumping crickets. And you're like, okay. And then you go and tell this guy, and he's like, oh, that's great, I'm a cricket aficionado. And I was just like, oh, God. And he's like, help me find some crickets. And I was like, oh, this is only going to go poorly. But it's cool, because it's like, that is a very Majora's kind of, like, little personal story. Help this guy fall in love, maybe, like, you know?
I realized what I was going to say about, like, my critique of Majora's just now. Is
okay.
That I like that it tells you you've triggered a quest, and not just, like...
Yes. Not just, like, figure it out. This is a thing.
Here's some dialogue, you know. It might just be throwaway dialogue. It might be a side quest. Who knows?
Yeah. The quest log is very effective in that way. And, like, just that overall theme of, like... I know, like, Anuma... and if you don't know that, he's the director of Zelda. Of the series in general. Has, like, talked a lot about how, like, they really wanted to move away from hand-holding and everything. And, like, he apparently got in a very, like... heated debate with one of the other like main developers about giving even one. There was one hint that they wanted to put in. He was like, "No, no hints. We're not fucking putting hints in this game." And it's like, it's like, dude, like, it was a bold choice, but it fucking, it's so. I'm so glad. Like, I'm
That's
so
awesome.
Glad. It's like, if you guys have ever watched Ego Raptor Sequelitis on Ocarina of Time, it's like literally like if you just like that one complaint that people have been levying at Zelda ever since then, it's just, like, it feels like that whole thing about, like, I was talking about with Pokemon, that they were like, oh, we just do the same thing over and over again, huh? Well, fine! Like, flip the fucking table, because it's, like...
And then they took all the hand-holding from Zelda and just put it in Sun and Moon on top of Pokemon's regular hand-holding.
Well, that's a different problem that Pokemon has. Pokemon didn't fix the hand-holding. Zelda did, so... but yeah, you know, the gym thing. The overcorrection of, like, oh, it's the same formula every time. Let's break the formula.
I mean, that's what every Zelda game is, though. It's an overcorrection for the criticisms levied at the last Zelda.
Kind of.
Like, people criticize Wind Waker for being, you know...
too easy.
Too, like, easy and bright and colorful and, like, the fucking go find the Triforce quest.
Yeah. So then we get...
Then we get...
Dark, gritty Ocarina of Time...
Yep. What's the grittiest thing you can turn into? A fucking wolf.
The only Legend of Zelda game to earn a T rating.
Didn't this one earn a T rating?
No, E10 plus, because there's alcohol in it.
Okay.
But it's not, like, super obvious. So, from what I understand, anyway. I haven't seen it.
Also,
I've
like...
read about it.
Twilight Princess is grimdark as shit.
Yeah. I mean, like, that was very in the zeitgeist at that time.
Yeah.
But,
like... it's not bad. I think it holds
up. No, it's fine, yeah. It's just, like... I don't know. I like that game fine, but it's not... I don't have the same feeling about it that I do about its predecessors, where, like, if I'm gonna go back and play an old Zelda game, like, that's low on my priorities.
I put Twilight Princess in there. I, like... I prefer...
Spaz likes it a lot,
too. I prefer Wind Waker more as a game, I think, but I think Twilight Princess's dungeons are incredible.
I honestly, it might have the best dungeons.
And, like, that's what...
The really good,
like,
ones.
The Zelda's about for me,
yeah.
You know? It's, like, the one dungeon where it's just, like, help a Yeti clean out his house, and that's the whole dungeon.
Yeah.
And then at the end, his wife wakes up, and she's the boss.
Yeah, that's really fun. I don't know, like, my whole
thing... Like, Link's Beyblade skateboard?
That's so ridiculous. That fight is really cool, too.
Yeah.
That, like, big, yeah, that's really cool. I really didn't like the wolf thing. I think I'd like that game a million times more if it didn't have the transformation, just because, like, worked in Majora's, but, like, that was the gimmick of Majora. And, like, it was so fleshed out that, like, it worked for me. And I feel like the wolf stuff, like, I always just feel like I just want to get back to being Link.
The wolf stuff in the end game, I think, is cool. Like, the mandatory, like, wolf beginning to each map segment you get is dumb.
Yeah, that's not fun.
But
the, like end game content.
The end game, like, turn into a wolf at a specific time to do stuff.
Like, in the fight with Ganon, the use of the wolf form is really cool.
Yeah, and, like, the... fuck, like, two-thirds of the way through the game, like, Dark Link steals your soul and you get stuck in wolf form.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
And it's, like... It is cool, but that is one of my least favorite parts of the game, just because, like, I really don't like the trope in games of, like, take your powers away. And, like, that's what that is. Like, it gives you a different power set, but it doesn't feel as well developed as the power sets that we got in Majora's, where, like, I didn't mind being in the other forms, because I felt like I could still do things, you know? Like, whereas I always feel limited as the wolf.
Okay.
And, you know, to take it back to Breath of the Wild, what I love about it is, like, how totally autonomous I feel whenever I walk into a combat situation, too. Like, it doesn't feel like, oh, this is the way to beat this enemy. You know, it's like, this enemy has health, kill them. You know, and, like, that's fun. Like, it's fun to...
See that guy? He's the deadest guy.
God, go watch Donkey's video. It's funny.
Put a link to it.
Yeah, absolutely. But, you know, man, it's, like, just, like, things of, like, I forget who, I don't know if it was somebody I was talking to in person, or if it was, like, listening to a pundit at this point, like, it all bleeds together, but someone was talking about how they never, ever use the bombs as a combat weapon. And I use the bombs in every fucking combat situation, because they are so funny. Like, it is so funny to be, like, okay, Like last night, right, I'm playing, and I'm coming home from the movies with my girlfriend, and I'm playing, and I just start laughing my ass. I'm just like, what? So,
oh, shit.
about 50% of Andy Brown for half of this podcast.
It's more Andy Brown than anyone really needs.
So, I'm ducking behind this, like, log, right?
Okay.
And there's a campfire of moblins. There's, like, a ton of them. And they have these, like, detonated barrels that they throw at you.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sitting there, and I crouch behind the log, I pull out a bomb, and I just, like, chuck it, and it, like, rolls over, and I wait until it rolls next to one of the, the crates, and then as soon as they notice it, like, one of them goes over and, like, picks it up, and then I just blew it up, and then just, like, the entire thing is engulfed in flames, and there's one of them left afterwards, and he just, like, comes at you like a fucking, you know, brick shithouse. And it's just, like, there's so many moments of that kind of, like, stuff that Ubisoft are talking about in Watch Dogs. Like, they've been trying to do in their games, like, anecdotal stuff. Like, anecdotal gameplay where it's, like, it's not a mission or a quest or whatever. It's just, like, moments that happen while you're exploring the game world and just having fun that are so cool that you want to talk about them.
I have yet to play this game. But you know what game does that better than any game I've ever played and you should really fucking play? Metal Gear Solid 5.
Alright, Andy. Maybe I'll finally try Metal Gear. It's just like, I feel so weird jumping into Metal Gear with Metal Gear Solid 5.
I mean, Metal Gear Solid 5 has, like, very little plot you don't go looking for.
Yeah. I guess I could just play it mechanically.
Yeah.
And enjoy it.
Playing it mechanically is a lot of fun. It's just like, you get a dog.
And then a horse.
A dog, a horse,
a half-naked lady,
and a robot are your companions. The dog makes sneak mode so fucking easy, though, because eventually you, like, level up your relationship with the dog and have, like, the boys back at HQ just kid him the fuck out.
That's awesome.
So eventually you can, like, give him a knife and just be like, do it, and he'll run up and stab a dude to death.
That's awesome as fuck. Oh, man. I think my one criticism of this game is I'm not able to pet the dogs.
That's everybody's criticism.
Yeah.
Yeah. 0 out of 10.
When are you going to patch in dog petting, Nintendo?
Imagine if they did.
I could see it. It's not impossible. So, one other thing about dog companions. I, like, really wanted to buy the Wolf Link amiibo so I could summon the Wolf Link, but I found out that the amount of hearts he has is contingent upon your progress in,
Twilight Princess
HD. Yeah, and it's like, I don't want to replay that game.
That's great.
It is great, but... So what I think I'm going to do, Spaz's brother Rocky is playing it right now, and I'm going to scan my amiibo when he beats the game, so I can summon, like, stacked-ass Wolf Link to just fight people with me. Because, yeah, I mean, like, some of these big-ass bosses I could probably use for backup. Oh my god, one more random thing I want to talk about, and then we'll wrap it up. So, I read the other day about how you can not only mount the horses, you can mount... Casey, our friend of the show, Casey Hendricks, discovered you can mount deer. You can also mount bears. I didn't even know bears were in the game.
That's awesome.
I was just like, what? There's bears? And it's like, and you can ride them? Jesus, man.
And you can fucking, you know, trick chickens into being your weapon.
Yeah, you can chuck cuckoos at people, and if, like, another enemy slashes at them, they'll come and swarm and kill everything. And you. So you gotta run away. But yeah. It's pretty crazy. One last anecdotal thing about stuff you can discover. I also found out there's a giant horse that you can find. It's twice as big as every other horse in the game. It's like the king of horses. It has infinite stamina, and it's like it's slow, but it like never gets tired, and it has maxed out power, so you can use it like a battering ram and just
That's
charge
awesome.
People. It's like fucking awesome.
It's the king of red horses, like
it's actually giant and blue.
King of blue horses.
So yeah, man, I mean like
king of red lions, king of blue horses. Same
yeah,
thing.
You
right?
got it.
He's the Pope.
He's the Pope!
Secretly the King of Hyrule.
And apparently you can fucking go to the island from Link's Awakening with the windfish and everything. Like, it's not there, but, like, you can go to it. And it's like, I don't know. I'm just so excited. This game is so good. The level of exploration, the level of fan service is perfect. The combat is great. It's so fucking fun.
Can Link boost Rhoda up?
No, but you can get... you know those, like, little sprite guys... Like,
yeah.
They're not Kokiris, but they're like the Koroks or whatever.
Yeah.
You can get a I think it's called a Kokrok leaf or whatever. It's this big-ass leaf that you use whenever you're on a boat. And you can use that to, like shoot a huge gust of wind and push people off cliffs and stuff.
That's awesome.
So it's pretty close.
Yeah. One more question that's actually a concern I've heard. How's the voice acting?
Like, not frequent at all. So, like, if people have a problem with it, like... It's like, I haven't experienced enough of it to really care. Like, it's like, Zelda has a voice in the beginning of the game, and a few times periodically, and when you encounter a major, like, story, like, cutscene, generally the beginning of it has voiceover.
Okay.
Some of, like, I know, like, there's one that Impa tells that's, like, entirely voiceovered, and it's like, it's fine. It's like, it's not...
Does Link talk?
No.
Okay.
He has dialogue, in the same way that, like, Link always has dialogue. Where, like, he talks, and, like, clearly he's talking because people are responding to him, you know? And the difference is that, like, you actually have dialogue options.
Okay.
It's, like, usually one or two things. Like, it'll be, like, you know, like, you're talking to Impa, and she'll be, like, oh, like, I can only give you this information if you're ready to, like, you know, like, really, like, dedicate yourself to being a hero or some shit like that. Like, are you? And you can be, like, yes! Or, you know, or, like, stuff like that. So, it's, like, it's very, very mild and no voice for him.
Okay.
And the general dialogue that you encounter is classic Legend of Zelda of you talk to someone and they go, ah! And then they're standing there like,
okay.
So it's like, it's totally, yeah.
That's the importance.
Par for the course.
Yeah.
Any other final questions, wrap-ups?
Final questions, thoughts? Not really.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, like, don't. Consider this, like, our official review or anything of Zelda. I'm sure we'll be talking about it more in the weeks to come, but, like, it was just something I wanted to touch base on more than I now had more concrete thoughts about it.
Cool.
So,
I'm gonna get Thompson in here next week so me and Thompson can talk tales.
Yeah, definitely. I'm, like, yeah, also, if you're watching right now, like, go, just go reach out to Thompson and send him some words of encouragement. He's been having some familial issues that have kept him off the couch, so I know he's missed being here and missed, being able to do stuff with you guys, so... if you can send him some words of encouragement,
just
I'm sure
he'd
appreciate
it. Tell him he's weeb trash.
Just tweet at Relic Vampire and be like, look, I love you, Thompson, but you're weeb trash. Get back on the podcast.
do that right now on the podcast.
Do it. While you do that, I'm going to remind the folks that that wraps it up for this episode of the Slackcast. If you guys liked it, please like it, share it with a friend, and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. And make sure if you have, thoughts on any of the stuff we talked about today, you want to talk about what you're thinking about Legend of Zelda, news items you'd like to see us discuss, let us know in the comments below or hit either of us up on Twitter. You can also write us an email at slackcast.media@gmail.com if you want to have your questions around the show. Or, again, write in about stuff you'd like to hear us talk about. Whatever. Let us know. And come back tomorrow for another Let's Play. I'm not sure what we're doing, but it'll probably be a fun one. And I'm just vamping at this point while Andy does this. Are you done? Say bye to the kids.
Bye, kids.
Bye, kids. We'll see you next week on another episode of The Slackcast.